thank you for the organizers for inviting WHO to come, and it was a pleasure to be in Uppsala. It's my first trip to Sweden, so it's a double pleasure. And like Sharon briefly introduced me, I come from Brazil. I'm not an oncologist nor a scientist. I'm a medical doctor. I used to be a pediatrician, and now, as I graduate in 1980, I say if I go back to treating patients, I'm a danger to patients right now. So I better stick to what I'm doing. In the past 7 months, I've been with WHO, and after many, many years in the Brazilian health system and at all levels. And one of the things that a friend of mine the other day was saying, you know, is he was saying, you don't sound like the UN. You know, you sound too much like a Brazilian. I said, well, I can't help it. You know, I've been Brazilian all my life, and we have a soccer game on, a football game match on Sunday. Maybe the national pride will come back. It's very low right now. But I'd like to say I think we live in interesting times, you know, because never before, I think maybe I'm almost 40 years graduated medical school, I bet never we had science, so many advances in science that can help change the face of disease in the world, right? The all manners, we can treat and prevent all manners of disease right now, and to different extents to save lives and so on. And the world has changed a lot. I think the colleague Arnie mentioned about the demographic changes, like life expectancy is rising everywhere in the world, in developing countries where you didn't get rid of the old health problems and you have the chronic diseases coming up with aging and so on. And as a chronic disease comes, and I'm saying this chronic instead of non-communicable diseases because there are communicable diseases that are also chronic, as they rise, the financial burden on individuals, on insurance, on governments also rise. And this, the new products that are coming up, and some of them are life-saving, like the hepatitis C drugs, they are coming at very high prices at the market. And what has this led to? It has led to an increased global concern. First, we had low and upper middle income countries worried about the rise in costs and affordability, sustainability of health systems. And now we have most high-income countries also concerned about the rising costs of healthcare. And we have, like, for example, the high cost for the latest treatment for cancer, for hep C, for orphan drugs, for rare diseases. Even insulin, which is also is a biological, will be 100 years old in 1923. It's becoming increasingly unaffordable in some high-income countries because it can cost up to $350 per vial. So we are in a bind. Data has shown, the colleague from the U.S. mentioned, but I'm going to say that 2015, the average prices for new cancer drugs in the U.S. varied from $7,500 per month to $28,000 per month. And as Thomas rightly pointed out, drugs are not the only cost. And there are some estimates that drugs in the U.S. They account for like 20% of the total cost for treatment. Then you go to the many developing countries and the situation is quite dramatic because in some countries up to 90% of the patients have to pay medicines out of their own pockets. And this means that 100 million people per year are driven into poverty because of health expenses. 100 million, it's a lot of people, you know. Medicines is the second largest expense following food for families in many countries. And for example, a short example, there are many. You know, I had enough to talk for half an hour, but I only have 10 minutes. So, like a family in Tanzania would, in most cases, spend 53% of the family income on a child with type 1 diabetes. Okay, so very sobering. Access to medicines, health products, it's clearly a very complex issue. Lack of access is really due to a single reason, as Thomas mentioned. We have from pricing to supply chain to service delivery to adequate management of intellectual property and competition. There are so many issues around it. But some of you may have seen earlier this year, there was an article in The Guardian that had a very interesting but also shocking headline. And it said, "Why should the poor die young? Closing the gaps on cancer outcomes. How money, cultural background, and geographic location are crucial in determining survival rates." And then some data around that. It doesn't come from the article, but from other sources. Childhood cancer survival, it's around 80% in high-income countries and as low as 20% in low-income countries. Breast cancer, 5-year survival, very high in Sweden. My own country, 58%. I saw data from India, 52%, can be 12% in the Gambia. Access to radiotherapy, 90% of patients in low and middle income countries do not have access. And I understand at least half of the patients need, that have cancer, need to have access. But then you have inequities, even in developed countries. You see there's data from the UK, like access to intensity modulated radiotherapy can vary from 20 to 70% depending where you live in the country. Access to pain relief, this was mentioned as well. There's an estimation that 45% of patients who died of cancer in 2015 had serious health-related suffering. And that's 80% in low and middle-income countries. So, of course, inequality, the world's unequal. But inequities in health, they are different because they can be addressed. Maybe you can't solve everything in the world regarding inequality, but access to services is doable. They are actionable. They are unjust, they are preventable, and they are actionable. So we have a moral imperative to address these gaps, you know, all of us. And I think we have at least two consensus when discussing access to health products. First, we have a sustainable development goal number 3, which is the health SDG, that says affordable access to safe, quality assured, effective medicines and vaccines as a pillar of universal health coverage. The second that I think we can also say it's a consensus, that a medicine that sits in the shelf because or in the warehouse because it's unaffordable, it's useless for patients and it's also useless for the manufacturers. So we need to have a better partnership. Partnership is a big part of the Agenda 2030, which is the Sustainable Development Goals. So the question is, can we make it work? Can we reduce these inequities? So let me look from different angles on pharma, and I'm going to provoke my friend Thomas here. Right? Global expenditure on medicines per year is forecast to reach $1.5 trillion by 2021. Not a bad business. Right? The health technology industry has one, if not the highest net margins of any industry. Right? It's 20%. It's followed 15% by technology industry, IT, and so on. And third is, I think, it's financial. Pharmaceutical companies need to recoup their investment in R&D. They say that less than 10% of new medicines are ultimately approved. No. But at the same time, last year, some Harvard researchers found that the 10 largest pharmaceutical companies spend between 7% and 21% of the total sales in R&D, on R&D. So the question for pharma, and Thomas has heard me before, is would probably what is a sustainable return on investment that actually leads to affordable access. Right? On the impact on the new drugs, you may know that WHO's essential medicines list the model is now 40 years old. It has a cancer working group. This cancer working group noted that close to 75% of the drugs approved in the last 15 to 20 years lacked evidence of substantial clinical benefit for patients at registration. And there are several examples on this. And I see that the moderator is starting to get up, so I need to cut some up. The bottom line from many articles, and we have studies from EMA and from the FDA over time, that prices of some of the new innovative medicines do not necessarily have a relationship to the increase in benefits provided to patients. So On the health system side, I think we, from early diagnosis to capacity for health services to provide in a timely manner, I think the example from India is very inspiring, and I loved your presentation. It really, really, it's good for my heart to see things being done that way. Because in low and middle income countries, cancer patients are diagnosed at a later stage, and most don't have access to most of the technologies we are talking about. So the question is for countries, are countries who spend money domestically buying the drugs that will be bring the greater benefit? And now on WHO side, 2 minutes for me to finish. With, I think everybody agrees, no public sector or health insurance system can afford to supply and reimburse every drug that's on the market right now. So we need to make a good selection. In this sense, the essential medicines list is a model that the idea behind is very simple. Some medicines are more important than others, and which are them? Right? For cancer, this process is much more complex because it involves, there are so many new drugs and so on. In 2014, we had 30 medicines for cancer, all off patent, for adults, and 16 for children. In 2015, we had a huge review with the UICC and moved to a disease-based approach. We added 16 medicines for adults and 10 for children. And for the first time, patent medicines and high-cost medicines were included in the essential medicines list. In 2017, 3 drugs were recommended, plus fentanyl patches. And other drugs were not recommended because of the need to perform a more comprehensive review. And this, just to finalize, saying that the cancer group is the EML, the essential medicine, is working with some parameters now. That selection and prolongation of life is a key criterion, and surrogate outcomes like disease-free progression are less strong. So it's gonna stick to that. WHO has approved a cancer resolution in 2017 and will be reporting back on price and affordability and access to drugs and to health technologies in January this year. And last but not least, we just approved a global program of work, which is WHO's strategy for the next 5 years. And I'd like to say that access to morphine is one of the indicators. It's a very important one. So we are acutely aware that everybody in this room, you know, has a role to play in making access to affordable, safe, effective medicines available to everyone. And industry is one of them. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mariângela.